Every day, hundreds of millions of vehicles burn fossil fuels, releasing tons of greenhouse gases into the atmosphere. Global warming is a fact, and scientists are now in a race to find clean, sustainable alternatives to fossil fuels. The two-part series, Cellulosic Biomass, goes inside Canada's fledgling biofuel industry and explores the groundbreaking research that's paving the way to a cleaner, brighter future. This wheat field has just been harvested. All that's left is straw, worthless fiber. Or is it? Locked inside the cellulosic fiber of countless agricultural crops is a treasure trove of energy in the form of sugar, a key ingredient for making ethanol. Knowing how to extract this sugar economically is a major goal of the Canadian Cellulosic Biofuel Network, an agricultural research group which supports Canada's emerging cellulosic biofuel industry. Margie Gruber and Serge Laberge are scientists with Agriculture Canada and co-founders of the network.
Whether in pretreatment, enzyme production, or using new yeast strain, we can break down cell wall faster and get more sugar out of the plant than ever before, and it's very exciting.
Before sugars can be extracted, biomass needs to be pre-treated to loosen a stiffening agent called lignin that holds cellulose and hemicellulose together, allowing enzymes to get inside and release the sugars. In Vancouver, Jack Sadler and his colleagues are fine-tuning a method to crack open biomass.
One of the things that our group came up with is what we call steam explosion. So use high pressure, release it quickly, and that basically opens up the biomass so that the microorganisms can then do their thing.
In the Okanagan Valley, Joe Mazza has found new ways to extract lignin and hemicellulose using liquid salts and pressurized water. Besides fuel, these can serve as building blocks for biochemicals. In Saskatoon, Tim DeMasso is experimenting with a white rot fungus, which breaks down lignin.
When the fungi permeate the biomass, it renders it very compactable, which is kind of something that doesn't sound very important, but it's a very meat and potatoes issue. If you produce your biomass on the farm and you need to get it to a biorefinery, the more compact a form you can put it in, the better.
Enzymes are the key to effective pretreatment. In the nation's capital, Wing Sung is developing heat-tolerant enzymes to reduce pretreatment costs. Meanwhile, in Lethbridge, Alberta, Tim McAllister's team is examining the contents of cattle stomachs for enzyme activity.
There's hundreds of different species of bacteria, protozoa, and fungi in the rumen that produce enzymes together in order to degrade feed. What we're looking at is trying to really identify the enzymes that limit that process, capture the genes that code for those enzymes from the rumen microbial community, and then use them in converting biomass into biofuel.
Halfway across the country in Montreal, Adrian Sang's research group is discovering new enzymes from soil fungi.
So we see these fungi as a laboratory in nature. Now we feed them with the different straws, then we know what type of genes are being used, what type of enzyme being used. If you want numbers, then we say we'll easily have about 1,500 genes for these type of enzymes.
Making ethanol requires fermentation of sugar, and yeast is a major component. Vincent Martin's group is using Adrian Sang's fungal genes to develop new yeasts which digest biomass into fermentable sugars. In Ottawa, Kristen Bates's team is searching for proteins that stimulate or inhibit fermentation and are discovering yeasts which ferment sugars not normally used.
So what we found were six strains that dramatically improved xylose or 5-carbon sugar utilization. And this was a remarkable breakthrough discovery because these genes were in completely different processes that you would have never suspected were involved in this.
Bates's team also conducts fermentation efficiency trials in Toronto and metabolome research in Edmonton. Harvesting and transporting bulky biomass to market can be expensive for farmers. In Saskatchewan, Mark Stumberg and the Prairie Agricultural Machine Institute help local farmers optimize their equipment and develop better harvesting methods.
There's a header that we've worked with a considerable amount. It's known as a Shelburne Reynolds stripper type header. And we're finding that it needed some modification to help it with our rolling landscape mostly. We've had really good feedback from these producers that we work with because we've shown them that with some changes that they can actually get a good return on their investment.
At the University of Saskatchewan in Saskatoon, Lopi Tabil is finding new ways to densify and pelletize biomass.
And this one is the non-treated biomass. It is crumbly and dusty. This one here is the steam-exploded biomass, and this one here is the microwave pre-treated biomass. Both these biomasses have a very good pellet quality.
The biofuel industry is eagerly watching these advances in research. Barry Wertzman is Vice President of Business Development with Greenfield Ethanol, Canada's largest ethanol producer.
If you have to use more enzyme than you wish, it becomes a non-commercial, non-viable process. And so those kinds of activities that your organization is involved in, along with others, extremely important.
Jim Gray is CEO with Ontario's Integrated Grain Producers Cooperative and past chair of the Canadian Renewable Fuels Association.
I think there's a real opportunity for the Canadian Renewable Fuels Association and the BioNetwork to work collaboratively with industry and with government. That is going to really drive the competitive success of so-called next generation biofuels in the future.
But what does the public think about using agricultural biomass to generate green fuels like ethanol?
I think it's incredibly important. I would support any kind of move in that direction.
Using biomass is a great idea because you're not actually using the part that of the grain that is used for food.
I think it's brilliant. It's there and it's in abundance. Might as well use it.
It's a good way to cut down on greenhouse gas emissions. It also helps farmers make a couple extra bucks.
The need to find clean, sustainable alternatives to fossil fuels increases day by day. But cellulosic biofuel is within reach. For the scientists of the Canadian Cellulosic Biofuel Network, this remarkable collaboration represents a unique opportunity to fast-track Canadian biofuel development.
It's a great feeling knowing that we're working on something that will affect our lives and the lives of our children. I mean, green fuel for a clean planet and new use for agriculture, who can beat that?